Hello and welcome back to French Bread's Dark Souls 3 Lore Run. I am French Bread, or Chris if you prefer, and we are right back, well, exactly where we left off before, having just been tricked, if you want, by Patches. So that leaves us with a quandary of how to get to Patches, now that we have triggered his initial event. And the answer to that is going to be... Oh, we got a Thrall Axe. Is going to be that lift that we did not take earlier in the playthrough. I believe in the last episode. Because unfortunately, if you... Let's see what our... Estes, we're good. If you take this lift up and you play around the upper level too much before encountering Patches, you are going to break this encounter. Patches isn't going to show up. You can still get Sigurd to show up in the well, but Patches will be gone, and you'll have to trigger him with a later event instead of that one, which is fairly frustrating because I think just about anyone's first time through here, you're very unlikely, I feel, to ever trigger this event, because the requirements seem to be that you need to open all the shortcuts, reload, or perhaps even leave the cathedral entirely. And then you have to come back, and for some reason, get close enough to the well to even know Sigurd is there. But of course, at this point in the game, once you've opened all the shortcuts, you don't really have any reason to ever run by that well again. You're taking the shortcuts you've unlocked behind the bonfire in the cleansing chapel. So it just doesn't make any sense to me why they would have set it up this way. And furthermore, in opening those shortcuts, you're likely going to discover the path up here, and once you do that, well, you're likely to follow up on that. And I don't know, it's just I didn't discover, I don't know about anyone else, but in my first blind playthrough of the game, I did not discover Patches in this location. And I had no idea it was even an event until later, because it's really, really friggin' obscure. So, yeah, I apologize, but I feel like I have to complain about that, because it's a great event, but I feel like they're a bit boneheaded with the triggers for it. Ooh. Hello, title card. But, you know, thankfully, it's all sorted out now that I'm doing my lore run, but I do feel like that was something they could have improved upon. Where's my life? My life should be fine for dealing with a few of these thralls. Another pale tongue. Running into, I think it's our second one we've found in the Cathedral of the Deep. I wonder if there's a... Well, we know there's a reason for that. We've already talked to Leon Hard. We know somebody's lurking around here. By the way, echoes of... Looks like he's going to do himself anyway. echoes of An Orlando. I don't know why I keep saying An Orlando wrong. Not sure. But we got definite echoes of the infamous railway sequence, catwalk sequence, that we assume was what finally bested Tarkus. It's far less nerve-wracking. Is that Miss Backstab? It's far less nerve-wracking here than it was in Dark Souls 1, but it's still... When you're fighting these kinds of enemies, it's still a little intense. Oh, I ran out of stamina. Still took care of business. Get ourselves a blessed gem. Maybe I'll break my rule real quick and equip this parry shield. If I can still remember how to parry these guys. I'm gonna want my life though. In case I screw up. Like so. There we go. When you're in this kind of situation where, like, moving around too much might mess you up, parrying isn't a bad idea because you're pretty static during it. Item? No item. And I'm not gonna do this whole run, even though, I don't know, maybe you'd want me to, but, like I said, I'm trying to push myself to do, to utilize different tactics than the ones I'm comfortable with. Oh, see what I mean about movement. We missed it again. We must just be slightly too far away. Oh shit! I did it. I didn't know they had force. Touche, FromSoft. Touche. I didn't know they had force. I thought he was gonna heal. I'm like, haha, stupid Hollow. Stupid Hollow indeed. Alright, we'll try to blitz back. I guess the nice thing about Dark Souls 3 is that there aren't too many truly long runbacks, if you know what I mean. Like in Dark Souls 1, if I were doing a run of that and I died somewhere, or God help me, Demon Souls, I would be booting up the video editor, fast forwarding, because tended to take a lot longer in those games to get where you needed to go. But not so much the case. Oh, he held it! I don't like this at all. Number one thing that's still gonna get me with the parry shield is when the enemies hold their attacks like that. Exposing myself as a non-master parrier, which is 100% true. Let's see, where did they all end up? Of course they did. I don't trust this little bastard. Not to mess with us. Fuck you. And I don't think, knock on wood, I don't think that this other guy's gonna give us shit. Wouldn't let us kick his shield, but this works just as well. We're still gonna have to deal with that guy now that I think about it. Ay ay ay. We can do this. Believe in the heart of the cards. was a little quiet there, but I wanted to focus on actually getting my parries as opposed to, well, you know. You know. So, we are up here. We got our blessed gem, and at first blush, that seems like the only thing you can get here, which is what I thought the first time I came through the game, to be honest, but nope. We've got this going on down here as well. Just make sure you have the health for the drop. Both of them. God, that was about the same amount of damage. And now we are formally introduced to these new enemy types that we only caught a glimpse of before. Behind us, I do believe. I thought more dropped down from above. Perhaps not at the moment. I'm going to raise this back up. And then we're going to have a nice friendly discussion with Patches here. Take a quick look at the legend as he appears in this game. Standard Patches. Black leather set and a shit-eating face.
Huh? Yes, hello. Oh, I don't believe we've met. I'm Patches. Unbreakable Patches. But you seem to be unkindled. Do you have business with me?
Just trying to play it off, huh?
Oh, yes, of course. It's coming back to me now. Oh, I'm so sorry. That was my hand, as you know. But the deed, well, that was the armor's doing. Regrettable, truly. But behold, I'm stripped clean of that unruly attire. And look at you. Not a scratch. All's well that ends well, right? Yes, we'll be fine. I can tell. It's that rotten curse. It is. The untidy mess.
It was the armor's fault, huh? The cursed evil armor of Katarina Patches?
Oh, yes. Now, it wasn't me, but you still deserve an apology. Just a little trinket. Go ahead. It's yours now.
Well, this is more useful than some things he's given in the past.
You should know, I'm a kind of traveling merchant. If you're as unkindled as you look, you'll find plenty of good stuff.
So, let's check out his inventory. He sells black fire bombs, as well as rope black fire bombs, human pine resin, luring skull, rubbish. He's actually selling rubbish for 200 souls. The bastard. He also sells the parrying dagger. Dagger with a greatly curved guard. A dagger made especially for parrying, which is usually equipped in one's left hand in place of a shield. He also sells two shotals. Broadly curved sword known as the favored weapon of the tragic embraced knight. Shaped to sneak around the defenses of shields, this sword requires ample dexterity to wield effectively. So, as it implies, these were the weapons wielded by Lautrec the Embraced. We've mentioned him briefly before, but he was a treacherous sort of NPC in Dark Souls 1 who you rescued, but ultimately would take the life of the Firekeeper at Firelink Shrine. And he wielded two shotals and a parrying dagger as his sort of main setup. And I do believe in Dark Souls 1, the shotals were specifically attributed to Earl Arstor as being something of his own invention. So, that's interesting. Winged Spear. A long-hilted spear with winged lugs. Long reach and can be used with shield up. Spear attacks are centered on thrusting. but can inflict high damage when timed at the end of an enemy's swing. So, no particular lore there, but this is the preferred weapon of Patches so far in the Dark Souls series. Pyrrhus Shield. Or Pyrrhus Shield. An unusual style of round shield, peculiar to the Knights of Katarina. The center of the shield features a large, sharpened spike, which is used to skewer opponents. And he also, quite curiously, is carrying the Katarina armor. I wonder where he got it from. Katarina Helm. Distinctively shaped helm worn by Knights of Katarina. Often ridiculed for its onion-like shape, infuriating the country's proud knights, but makes the masterfully forged curved design makes it very effective for deflecting blows. So we're gonna snap this up right now. He also sells the black leather armor. This was the starting armor for the thief class in Dark Souls 1, and typically what Patches wears, though the picture we're seeing is of the female version. It's one of the very, very few armors in the game that has a distinction between male and female. Not in stats, but just in how the armor looks. Black dyed leather armor enables its wearer to hide in the shadows with silent finesse. The wearer of this fine attire was admired by friends and enemies alike, for his skills were unmatched and his heart was true as gold. As its new owner, you have quite the shoes to fill. I get this distinct impression that Patches is trying to play up his own gear with, well, the standard amount of Patches lies. And he sells poison arrows! I wish to God they were as good in this game as they were in previous ones. I'm gonna buy this as well, because I like this armor. We're gonna leave it at that. Do I need to buy it? I'm gonna buy this just in case. I don't think I need to buy this, but well, we got some change to spare, so we'll do it.
Thanks, sweetie.
And that is it for Patches for now. We will encounter him again later, I assure you. Or at least sooner than later. But for now, that's what we got. Now, before we go ahead and return this armor to Sigurd, let's take a look at what's before us. It's kind of a gross sight. Indeed, mangrubs, as they're called, I believe, adhering to the walls everywhere, in many places staked to the walls with those distinctive stakes that I pointed out before. I am fat rolling because of the Ring of Sacrifice. There we go. See, this is really what makes me feel like these are, like, used as charms or to form a barrier of some kind. Because just look at the perimeter of this place. Well, we'll try to look at the perimeter of this place once we deal with all these gross-ass enemies. Y'all dead over there? I keep getting the AoE effect, but not the actual damage. There we go. All staked up, and just a huge, huge number of them all lined up along this wall. All these candles lit. A gate. A door and a gate that looks to be have bent non-distinctly. That's clever. I can't tell if this gate was busted open or busted into. We have all these guys lining up here. And this guy, who is... we can lock on to him, but he doesn't appear to be hostile at all, so let's take advantage of the situation to get a foul look at mangrubs. Kind of, just this non-distinct mass of pulsing flesh. and a somewhat carnal looking staff, if I do say so myself. Looks like two bodies in some sort of embrace. These mangroves, you know what they really remind me of is actually a reference to Pathfinder, the tabletop RPG, and probably D&D as a result. I don't really know too much about actual D&D, but in Pathfinder, humans are said to take on a larval grub-like form, and sometimes when they go to the Abyss, the home of demons, before they have the potential to turn into demons themselves, they turn into these disgusting grub-like forms, which I suppose in some ways reflect the true nature of humanity. And if you see here, sorry to make you look at this some more, but yeah, those are feet. I don't know what kind of transformation this is, but it is 100% creepy. Very fucking cool. This might be our real title card. I think it will be. We'll use the other one for the last episode. Oh. I suppose I should do something about this guy right here. He's non-hostile. And I do beg of you to remember that this guy was here. I'll bring it up again, but remember this guy was here because I have a theory about his identity. But for now, fuck this guy. Gives us the red sign soapstone. Let's take a look at that right now. Be summoned to another world as a dark spirit and defeat the host of embers to gain the strength of fire. Not all dark spirits are unsporting, or they wouldn't make use of this soapstone. So you lay it down and somebody can choose to summon you to have a duel. Hopefully an honorable duel. Hopefully not a duel where they just gang up on you with their other white phantoms, because they're scumbags. I'm not salty. Oh boy, this area is fucking cool looking. Cradles on the ground, hanging from the ceiling, giant covered statues of something. Hard to tell what. Another great chandelier, and this, what a great area this is. Or these statues on the wall. And at the center of it all. Hey, what's this? Ah! It looks like Kirk won't be coming back anymore. He won't be visiting us three times. Oh, there's gunk on the ground, kind of seeping up through the floor. But no, that's not the real reason we're here. The real reason we're here is this individual. Yep. Very... very interesting character right here. Some sort of vile, like truly vile growth she's got cradled here on her lap. And her hair is very long, and there's some sort of like substance on it as well. I'm not even going to begin to theorize on that. But it spills out into the area here. You can see. I guess it's supposed to be going under the bed there and then out through that way. Doesn't have anything to say to us right away. But let's make sure we get a good look at this NPC. There's feet. So we know she's got feet. She's not actually this slug creature. It's just something she has with her. Let's talk. Rosaria, Mother of Rebirth. Rosaria's fingers. So before I get into... Oh, there's a foot there too. Before I get into lore, you can offer Pale Tongues to improve your Covenant level. You can use Rosaria, again, Pale Tongues are used for all of these, to reallocate your attributes, to respec, basically. Or you can use her to alter your physical appearance, which is a great new addition to the game, but you can only do these two options, I believe, 5 times each cycle. So for some vague reason, they decided to put a limiter on it. She does not talk very much because, well, we should already know if we would think back to the other items we've gotten. Claiming tongues as trophies was originally the practice of an infamous troop of invaders who offered them to their speechless goddess. Sacred seal of Archdeacon Klimt, who served Rosaria, Mother of Rebirth. Equipped to pledge oneself to Rosaria's Fingers Covenant. Rosaria's fingers collect tongues in her name. Some do it to be reborn. Others do it to help comfort their voiceless goddess. Archdeacon Klimt. Archdeacon Klimt. Oh boy. You know how we picked up another item earlier? Saint Bident? A silver bident decorated with a holy symbol, formerly wielded by Saint Klimt. He discarded this weapon that draws upon one's faith on the day that he put his own faith behind him. Damn. Damn, damn, damn. Rosaria is such, like, again, as I said before, I didn't really give her that much credit initially, but I feel like now she is such an important character to understanding what's going on here. Or at least better appreciating the lore of this world. Longfinger Kirk had served her. Yellowfinger Hazel serves her. And we know Ringfinger Leonard is actively serving her and trying to recruit more people to assist her for whatever reason. And I mentioned before that I had a theory on why Kirk, a man who is certainly dead, just randomly shows up in Dark Souls 3. That theory is Mother of Rebirth. I suppose that Rosaria may have brought Kirk back into this world to serve as one of her fingers. And there's another NPC we'll run into later who I believe is basically the same situation. I don't think there's any strong lore reason why Kirk is here other than that I think it displays the power of Rosaria. And this power, with a power like that, in a form so sinister, I can definitely understand why it would appear that Rosaria was sealed away on the upper level of the cathedral with all these, like, what I presume to be sealing spikes. And she must have some association with the deep that this cathedral was originally intended to protect the world from. This guy right here, I didn't expect to get the information so soon, but this guy right here I have a very strong feeling was Archdeacon Klimt, just kind of watching over Rosaria, as is said, as is described in that item description. There'll be more items later that will lend credence to this, but that's the strongest one that immediately comes to mind. Okay, that's settled. We aren't going to interact with Rosaria anymore for quite some time, though, unfortunately. We're not going to equip her Covenant item. We're not going to use her reallocation services, because doing any of this will break the quest chain we have going with Cirrus. She is opposed to this Covenant, and if we make any further gestures of allegiance to the Covenant, she will show up and say, so long, and, you know, it was good while it lasted, but we can't be friends anymore. So we're going to avoid that for now. But what we are going to do is get Sigurd's armor back to him. And don't worry, I got a lot more lore in the pipe for Rosaria, but we're not going to get more information on it for a little while.
I'm in quite a pickle indeed. Maybe I can...
Yeah, we know. How about we throw your armor?
Oh, my armor. My deepest gratitude. I, Siegfried of Katarina, salute you. With my trusty suit of armor, I'll be out of here in a jiffy. Until we meet again, comrade.
Can I get a new
one? No need to worry about me. With my trusties. Until we meet.
Okay. As always, Siegbro is great, but I'm confused. How does getting his armor help him get out of a well? If anything, wouldn't it make it more difficult for him to get out of a well? Adding extra weight and width? Wouldn't now be the time to strip away all your armor and try to scramble up the side? I'm not a knight of Katarina. I shouldn't judge. I don't know what secret techniques they possess. We'll just leave it at that. Did I rest up? I rested up. Excellent. So, what we're gonna do now is, true to our word, looks like we have time. We're gonna go introduce ourselves to the boss of this area. Oh, you. I'll never get tired of you. To do that, we gotta head back through this muck. Gross. Gonna move around here and once again try to reenact our plan of maybe killing these guys without immediately getting that big old knight's attention. We've failed that. We've failed that gloriously. Ah, misjudged my range. You. I don't need you complicating matters. I feel like I might be in some trouble. These guys. Well, that's put me right back in the danger zone. Sorry, I'm in a weird place with fighting these guys, right? Because I don't have my trusty parry shield going on. This shield doesn't block 100% damage, so it's kind of a weird try your best to find your opening sort of deal. It's a very weak excuse, but it's what I've got, so do forgive. It's interesting, it looks like this main altar is actually, like, tilted and is sinking into the ground somewhat. perhaps as a result of the deep bubbling up on this side. What I assume to be the deep. Maybe this whole cathedral is situated on top of an abyss. Maybe the abyss, maybe a abyss, maybe the deep, I don't know. Got another one of these covered statues. Well, many of these covered statues, actually. All centered around this area. I wonder, that's an idea. One theory is maybe that these depicted St. Aldrich before his... No, actually, now getting a look at one of them from this side, it does bear the silhouette of those distressed women, doesn't it? Which is making the gears in my head go even faster. I wish I could share it right now, but it's for later. Let's try our luck though and piss off this guy. Yay! Thank goodness for passivity. I'm gonna have to, after this episode, farm some of their gear. So we wrap around here and we can see the boss fog ahead. No drapes over them here, if that's what was going on. Interesting. Candelabras aren't lit here either. So I'm going to tackle this boss fight a little differently than normal. I'm going to allow myself to be killed because, or I might, I don't, yeah, I'm going to allow myself to be killed because I want to show off a certain aspect of this boss fight that I don't think people ever really encounter on their own. Deacons of the Deep, yeah, freaking cool boss room to boot. So the main gist of this fight is that this red soul or spirit or energy is being passed around between the various deacons, and you can't damage them unless you hit it. Once you do, exits that one, moves to another one. And you hope it goes to one of the small ones that you can one-shot, not these big baddies. Or the tall men. We're gonna keep progressing as if we wanted to win for now. Until this happens. The real enemy makes his appearance. Very cool. He's got a really cool staff there to his name. And what the hell is going on here? Oh, I didn't expect him to cast that so soon. Usually it takes a while. You've left your man exposed. Ah, he's denying me. That's fine. We gotta keep an eye out for this. Because these things... Ow, ow, ow. As you can tell, these things hit really hard. And they hit right through the wall, too. Keep an eye on this boss room as things develop. May need to do more damage to him. Let's find out. Yep, okay, see now things are getting more interesting. Let's please dodge! Oh, we didn't dodge at all. It's actually kind of hard to dodge. Here we go. You see now the deacons are starting to offer up this dark energy. Drifting up to the top of the arena. And now, do you see it? Do you see it flicker there for a moment? Oh shit. I don't know if that orb's gonna go through this pedestal too. This center coffin. It will! Okay. Oh shit. It's getting real up there. darkness is starting to pour, fill the room. It's doing the thing again. So they understand that I don't want it. I want to see this instead. See our curse building up, by the way? That's the effect of this darkness, and soon we'll be faced with death by curse. I wonder if those are deep gems they're forming around us. So yeah, once you initiate that fight, you are technically... Or once you initiate the second phase of that fight, you are technically on a timer. If you don't defeat the enemy within a certain amount of time, you're just going to succumb to curse damage. Which, it's almost impossible to die to this unless you are trying, like I was. I don't know about New Game Plus. Maybe on New Game Plus, the curse and the whole thing builds up quicker. But... as it stands, in this current fresh game, it's definitely something I feel like almost everyone is going to miss when they fight this boss, just because what kind of crazy man would stand around and allow this to happen? Now you know, but you have the answer to that question anyway. So now it's time for us to wrap this up in earnest. Did he really not notice us? That's fine with me. So now then, we have the ability to summon phantoms, and we're gonna do so because this boss fight is super easy once again, and I don't feel like I lose anything by bringing allied phantoms into the mix. Here's Henri. Let's get Horus in on this too, because these two have a stake in tracking down Aldrich. This is what they're here for. And it's good to see they made it this far. Now, I don't think we're going to see it because of the order I've progressed through the game, but we're going to go ahead and use our... We can't. Darn it. Ordinarily, here you could use a dried finger, and if you had advanced... I believe if you advanced Circe's questline a little bit further, her sign would show up here also. And you could actually have all three of these guys if you use the dried finger. But whatever. We're good with these two. Let's mess them up, guys. I'm gonna head over here, though, because I want these 100,000 souls badly. Nope, don't follow me. You're here for blood. Kill the deacons. Cut through the wave of flesh. So, this fight's super easy, right? But I love it. I think it's one of my favorite fights in the game, because it's really fun. Just getting an excuse to hack through walls and walls of these not particularly difficult enemies. Ah, force! These guys I knew had force. And there's that darn cathedral knight that I wasn't expecting it from. Rude. Let's get some magic weapon action going. Yeah, they like that. He lives. I don't appreciate that at all. Where are you sneaking off to? time? Not quite time yet. They're all spread out. Where's the... There he is. Where's the big man? Now I do believe we'll have our time. Hey, buddy. Afraid things are gonna go a little bit differently this time than they did before. My most sincere apologies. Yes, and his darkness. I don't appreciate it. Look at this dude healing. As you can see, the head guy here is not particularly threatening himself. He's kind of the embodiment of a person who fights with charisma rather than strength. You got him, guys. And that's it. That is it. God, that's cool. I want that to be a thing, too. So many options for this episode. I think we'll do Rosaria. I really wish I could do both, but it wouldn't make any sense. Anyway. Enough of that rambling. Let's light the bonfire here. Sit at it. And you see that a body has appeared. Archdeacon, white crown, holy garb, and skirt. Oh man, there's gonna be a lot to go over next episode. But for now, I'm afraid I'm gonna have to leave you hanging, as we've run out of time. Thank you, as always, for joining me, and I hope you'll show up again for the next episode. Until then, I'm going to bid you guys adieu and sign off. See you later, everyone.